part.
Good morning, church family. Glad to have you back again with us for worship this week. It's time for us to pause and give the Lord praise and thanksgiving for his love and his grace and his work within our lives. It has been a busy week. A lot has been happening here locally and, of course, within the world too. There are a lot of prayer needs, a lot of health needs, and of course, the world right now in Afghanistan, there's a lot of pain out there. So let's pause briefly and ask the Lord to help us to prepare our hearts and our minds for this morning, but also to recognize and trust in his sovereignty. Father, good morning. It's time now for us to gather as your church family. It's time now for us to set aside the busyness, the pressures, and just pause. Recognize that you are sovereign. We often say, yes, Lord, you reign. But right now, as we look out and see what's happening around us, we wonder. It's like we want to see your reign here. We need to trust that your plan has a purpose, not just for our lives individually, but for your people collectively. And this morning, I want to lift up specifically our Christian brothers and sisters in Afghanistan. They're trying to escape a horrid situation there. Of course, we pray for all of the people who are struggling there, but we especially think of our brothers and sisters who face certain death because of their faith, because they have rejected their former false religion and now recognize you as the true Savior of the world. That statement in and of itself, I know, is controversial. That you alone are the only way, the truth, and the life. Those people recognize that, and we praise God for that. Unfortunately, some of them will die because of their recognition of that. They'll die here on earth, but yet they still have life eternal with you in heaven. We praise God for that. And Lord, we ask now that you listen to our hearts. You hear our grief, our pain, but also our joys. We lift up the people that we love that are nearing death now. We ask that you give them comfort for them, but also for their family members and friends. Allow us as your people to represent you well during difficult times. Lord, give us courage. Help us to speak truth with love. And then give you all of the praise, glory, and honor that you deserve. Amen. Well, last week we began a new lesson, well, a new series from Paul's letter to the churches in Galatia. And last week was more of an introduction, and this morning we're going to be looking at verses 6 through 9, chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. So it's still sort of an introduction, but at the same time, Paul begins his teaching, and it's a hard lesson here for us. So chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. Paul writes in verse 6, "I'm astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ, and you're turning to a different gospel." That's really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion or trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we, or an angel from heaven, should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let them be under God's curse. Wow. Sorry, those were verses 6 through 8, not 6 through 9. A few weeks ago, when I was studying this passage, reading it, I remember one mother that I met in the community a few months ago. That night I was working with the police department here. They had called me about a mother and her 15-year-old boy that were they were fighting. So it was a domestic dispute. And, you know, they both got to the police station and they were separated. There was one officer with the mother and one officer with the son. Anyway, so I went in and I heard both of their stories. Now, the son had had a drug problem in the past, but he had been clean. But the mom was afraid that he would fall into drugs again, that he would get involved with the wrong people. And so she wanted to keep him safe. So she wouldn't let him out of the house. So the boy would just run out in the middle of the night, go out with friends. Now, he stayed clean, but, you know, he felt like he was a prisoner in his own home. From the boy's perspective, the mom was just overbearing and he couldn't handle it. She had no trust. He had no sense of freedom. He felt completely oppressed by her. And from the mom's perspective, you know, she's just trying to protect her son. But anyway, so this caused a huge disruption in their home. Anyway, the point is that I remember before I left, the mother came up and told me, said, you know, when he was a little boy, I had such big dreams for him. I had high hopes for him. But now, when I look at him, I feel like a failure. Oh. And I said, wait. You know, I tried to encourage the mom and I said, no. He's 15. You're not a failure. He's 15. He's been clean. He has a long life ahead of him. He still has so many opportunities to grow, to become a strong young man. Now, I don't know if I convinced the mom, you know, I had just met her, but I thought about our own high hopes, our own dreams, our own expectations. Maybe it's for family members, maybe for friends, for relationships. But when that fails, it's tough. Especially when it comes to our children, right? We teach them, we encourage them, we challenge them, and we want the best for their lives, right? And if that doesn't happen, it makes us second guess ourselves, right? Did we miss something? Maybe we should have done more. Maybe there were some things we shouldn't have done, and it can lead to a lot of regrets. But anyway, when I was thinking about Paul here in this passage, remember, Paul helped found that church in Galatia, and he had high hopes for them. He taught them and explained to them the gospel. He modeled a Christ-like attitude of love and concern and compassion for them. He showed them what it meant to live for Jesus and to live like Jesus. He cautioned them about false teachings. He warned them about lies that would be pervasive and cause confusion, and how important it was to remain focused, to remain centered on the gospel and the main message of Jesus Christ. That he alone was crucified, and to remain strong and finish well. And now here it is 9 years later, and Paul finds out that his spiritual children, so to speak, what he had taught them, many of them had strayed from. I mean, Paul poured out blood, sweat, and tears to establish the church there. And of course, the Holy Spirit empowered him to do that. But the Lord used Paul's physical and mental exhaustion to plant that church. And then now so many of them had just abandoned the gospel. And he is heartbroken. That's what we see in verse 6, heartbreak. He says, I'm astonished. It was shocking. The one who chose you because of Jesus' grace, you've just abandoned, deserted. And you are believing a different gospel. He's saying, I can't believe it. It's unbelievable. And what Paul saw happening there, the theological word is apostasy. And that word means that your beliefs, what you used to value, you've given up on. You've abandoned, gone a different direction. Walked away from it. They followed a different gospel. What other people told them they needed to believe, they just went along with it, even though they knew the truth. And it happens today too, often, right? You who have young adult children, maybe they go away to college. Those kids that grew up in the church, grew up in a Christian family, you raise them in a Christian home, they go off to college, they see things and hear things from so many different ideas and philosophies, and they come back home and they start talking about the things they start saying, and the parents are like, what? What is that? What happened? It's like they've just abandoned all that they grew up with, all that they believed, all that they learned, the truth, the Bible, what they had trusted. They just cast aside. They gave it up. But of course, apostasy can happen with adults too. You know that living as a Christian today is not easy. We've discussed it before. We have analyzed life today many times. Most of our family and family members and friends don't believe. And what's worse is that if you don't believe what they believe, it can cause even bigger problems from their perspective. That you reject them personally. And sadly, for some people, that's too much pressure. So they decide that those relationships are more important than their faith. And I'm sure you've seen that happen, right? Someone abandoning, letting go, giving up on their faith. What is your response? Are you shocked? Are you disappointed? Maybe a little judgmental? Maybe you don't mean to be. I hope you don't. But really, we should be grieving. We should grieve because their decision can have eternal consequences. If they don't repent, there are eternal consequences. Meaning, they're rejecting God himself. If they are not worshiping God, they will worship something else. Again, if they're not worshiping God, they will worship something else. All people worship something. Maybe it's another set of beliefs. Maybe it's another person. Maybe it's something that's more comfortable, that's a better fit, better aligns with the culture. But anyway, Paul writes here is that he's shocked. And what's worse is that the brothers and sisters there in Galatia hadn't even realized they had strayed. They believed that they were still Christians. But from their perspective, they didn't think that Jesus alone could save them. And again, they didn't realize that. But they thought that they needed Jesus plus the Jewish customs, the Jewish practices. So if they wanted to become a Christian, first they had to follow the Jewish laws. Today, what that might look like is, well, yes, I believe in Jesus, but I need to do something. I know I need to be kind. I know I need to help my neighbor. I need to stop my immoral relationship, and then he'll accept me. Even though that is not what the Gospels are, that's not what the Bible teaches. If I do something for my salvation, if I do enough to get into heaven, then that means that Jesus' sacrifice, his death for my sin, was insufficient. Like, oh, Jesus, thanks for dying, but let me do these other things to help you be able to save me. I mean, we know that Jesus' death is sufficient. And the reason that God sent Jesus, the reason that Jesus died for our sins, was for salvation. He never said, well, I'll come, but you know, before I can save you, you need to do all these things first. No. He said, I came, I love you, I died for you, follow me. But why would someone stray? Why would someone depart from their faith? I mean, how does that happen? Why does it happen? Well, there are two things. First, one author describes it as soul trouble. So, for example, maybe you have a personal crisis, some sort of tragedy, a major loss. Sometimes something happens that just rocks us, that just knocks us off of our feet, shakes us to the core, and we're trying to understand how that can possibly fit with what we believe. It challenges our faith. And so when we can't make sense of it, we look for something else to help us make sense. So for example, when someone dies, family member or a friend passes away, and of course, the pain of the loss is terrible. The person who is grieving seeks comfort. Well, if that family member who died isn't a Christian, and yet Jesus teaches about salvation, both heaven and hell, well, that's really hard to accept. That our loved one is not with the Father. We can't handle that. So instead, we look for anything that we can believe. Like we'll say, oh, well, now he's an angel. He's with the Lord. He's in a better place. Or, you know, he did a lot of good. He had a really big heart. I think God will accept him. And I get it. I mean, we try to reconcile what we know about the Bible and what we know of that family member. And the truth is just too painful. I know that specific example is really sensitive. And people will argue, you know, well, I still believe, I still believe. Okay, but what do you believe? Jesus' plain, clear teaching? Or do you believe something else? If you alter, stray from, or reject what the Bible teaches, whether it's in a little way or a big way, it is still apostasy. And Paul says in verses 6 and 7 again, It is not a gospel at all. See, some people are trying to confuse you, trying to pervert the truth about Jesus Christ. False teachers enter the body and spread lies, and that causes doubt, confusion, and discouragement. And when we're angry, or we're afraid, we're hurt. Like, let's suppose you find out what you thought was the truth all this time isn't. Oh, that's disappointing. I mean, you feel betrayed, right? It happens. I've seen churches out there fall apart because the pastor had an affair, or the pastor broke the law, or maybe the pastor's own faith he began to doubt. And the church family is hurt. It's confused. And disappointment. Incredible disappointment. They think, man, I trusted that guy. I believed God's word. I believed what Jesus taught about himself. And now I'm not sure. And they start to look for answers in some other place. They disappear from the church. They're disillusioned. What they thought was true is not, and they're just turned upside down. I've worked with Christian families through the years whose children were raised feeling loved and secure. Their parents showed them biblical love and grace. And then the parents get divorced. And those children are just totally thrown off. They're devastated. I mean, my parents' marriage, what they believed, what mom and dad taught me, what they lived, was all of it a lie? Was all of it hypocrisy? They may leave the church. They may give up on Jesus altogether and look for another religion. They may quit altogether. They may feel like they can't believe anything. I've seen it happen. And it's incredibly painful. And apostasy doesn't happen all of a sudden. Don't just wake up one day saying you don't believe anymore. It happens slowly. You don't notice it happening. And I wonder, does that scare you? Is there something there that you're overlooking? It should wake you up. Honestly, some of you right now maybe don't even realize that you've started drifting. Maybe you had a bad experience or a deep hurt. Maybe something happened. You try to convince yourself that you're fine, that you and God are fine. But you aren't. There's a serious danger there. You need to know how to avoid that type of straying. How can we remain focused and strong? Two brief things before we close. First, all that you've learned, you have to hold on to it. Cling tight. Reinforce it. Repeat it. Keep studying it. Remember it. The English word is tenacious. It's a stubborn determination. Again, your sin nature, the culture, Satan himself will try to pull you and pull you from the truth. And that's why Paul wrote in verse 8, even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we've preached to you, let them be eternally condemned. If Paul taught something erroneous, if he taught something that wasn't there in Scripture, if he taught a different gospel, let God curse him. He's saying, you hold fast to the truth. If anyone, including me, if anyone tries to teach you something that's not here, or maybe they tell you, well, you know, this book is flawed. You can't really trust the Bible completely. If someone tries to convince you that Jesus is not the only answer, I mean, yes, you know, he can help you get into heaven, but there are other religions that are just as good. Or if someone tries to convince you that God can't possibly forgive you, don't listen. Don't listen. You have to know the truth and you have to cling tight to it. I love this quote from Spurgeon. He says, and he's talking about the truth here. He says, cling tightly with both hands. And when they fail, hold on with your teeth. And if they fail, hang on by your eyelashes. Don't let go of the truth. Hold on. The second way that we avoid drifting is that the Bible must be our final and ultimate authority for our lives. The final and ultimate decision for what we believe, for how we live, has to be biblical. So we don't ask other people what they think. We look at what the Bible says. How you feel or how I feel doesn't matter. What does the Bible say? Human authority, church traditions, your opinion, my opinion, doesn't matter. Any idea or philosophy that contradicts God's word, nope, don't want it. So what's written here is the truth. We believe it, we accept it. For example, that Jesus is coming back. John 14:3, Revelations 19. That's what it says, and that's what we believe. Jesus will return. There is no doubt. There is no question. It's here and we believe it. The Bible commands us to love our neighbor. Love our neighbors. Not just a nice, kind gesture. No, it's a command. We have no choice. It's there. We have to. And I'll add, too, that when the Bible warns us about something, we need to pay attention. I know in general, people don't like to be warned about things. Feels like we're being scolded, right? We know better. We don't need that. I mean, that's our typical reaction. Oh, please, you don't have to warn me about things. But remember, generally, the purpose of the warning is for our protection. It's for our protection. It can save your life, right? We don't let a kid standing in the middle of the street, we warn them to get out, right? When our youth start driving, we warn them to slow down, lay off the gas pedal. As adults, we feel tightness or discomfort in our chest. We get warned to go to the hospital. You might have a problem with your heart. Most importantly, Jesus warns us in Matthew chapter 7. He says, you will enter the kingdom only through the narrow gate. Single file line. Only a few people will enter heaven. The wide gate? Nope. Jesus talks about a very narrow gate. And the warning there is that you who may believe that you're saved, are you 100% confident? I know apostasy can happen to anyone. Doesn't matter how long you've been a follower of Jesus. You have to pay attention. You have to think about who's influencing you. When our culture contradicts his clear instruction, oh, Satan loves that. He loves to use that against us. Right now, we are facing constant spiritual battles. Spiritual battle, there is a spiritual battle for your own soul. But also remember, God is faithful. God is faithful. Peter, one of Jesus's closest disciples, several times he came very close to straying. He misunderstood Jesus. He argued about Jesus' purpose here. Can you imagine? He argued with Jesus about his own purpose here. Happened in Antioch. Peter refused to eat with certain Christians because they weren't Jewish. We'll see that later on. Peter feared the reaction of his other Jewish friends. He clearly rejected the teaching. He denied Jesus before his crucifixion. All of that happened, and still Jesus cared for and protected him. Look at Luke chapter 22. Simon was his name, Simon Peter. Satan has asked to sift, to separate all of you like wheat, to cause separation, division. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. Jesus himself prayed for Peter, prayed for his faith, to remain, pray that he would remain strong. You know that now Jesus prays for your faith too. Jesus right now, seated at the right hand of the Father, praying for your faith. He won't leave you alone. Never. He will defend you. Jude chapter 4 says that he can prevent you from straying. His prayer is with great joy that he will present you before the Father without fault, meaning pure. So what you've learned, cling to that. Pay attention to his warnings and hope with confidence that in your hands, Lord, we are safe forever. Amen.